Welcome everyone to PHN Presents. I'm really pleased to be with you here today. My name is Ken Levinson, the Executive Director of the Passive House Network. With you today with Timothy Locke of Opal Architecture, and taking a look at the Waring New School and how they worked with the project, their practice overall, and really pushing the possibilities and the boundaries of what we can do. I'm particularly gratified to have this project here today with you and be with Timothy, because sadly, when we had our conference in Boston, Timothy had come down with COVID at that time, and we weren't able to tour it. So we're going virtual here, not on the job site, but looking forward to diving in at last. So a brief intro as folks are coming in of the Passive House Network. We are a national nonprofit educational organization. We are affiliated with the Passive House Institute in Darmstadt, Germany, and work with Passive House organizations around the world, including the North American Passive House Certifiers Circle, which is a group of over 25 Passive House certifiers who are actively working in the United States certifying to the Passive House standard. We have regional chapters growing across the US and encourage you to become a member. It's all about the community. It's about peer-to-peer knowledge sharing and really finding those local applications, the regional context, and sharing global knowledge. PHN is fundamentally an educational organization. We're about capacity building for high performance, low energy buildings addressing the climate crisis. We offer courses across the spectrum, starting with introductory courses, and we work with partners like Building Energy Exchange, core certification courses, CPHD, and I should have a logo up here, but we work closely with EMU, and then advanced specialized courses, and critically building certification, which we really consider kind of like, if not the graduate school, maybe the apprenticeship, but it's where the rubber really hits the road. And like most things, you learn by doing, and going through that certification process really helps you nail down your competency in being a Passive House professional. Coming up in December, on December 13th, we have asked the Passive House Certifiers event focused on multifamily buildings. And we're really happy to be speaking with Maureen Sanchez of RDH Building Science. So if you're interested in certification, you wanna learn more, you're working on a project, come ask questions. We will be talking about multifamily buildings. In the early part of 2023, we'll be doing it again with single family buildings and then hopefully moving into other building types. Coming up in January, we'll be kicking off two regional hybrid CPHD courses. So if you're in the Northeast, from Maine to Pennsylvania, or in the Rocky Mountains from Idaho to New Mexico, and you or someone you know is interested in stepping up their game in Passive House, definitely want to take advantage of this opportunity to do the course. It's a hybrid, part on demand online, part live online, and part in person, trying to bring together all those aspects. And then my last note here is the conference coming up 2023. We had a great conference in Boston in the spring. This year coming up, we're doing it in the fall, at the beginning of the fall, in Denver, Colorado, and we are now accepting papers for submission. It will be a hybrid conference, both online and in person, and hope you can join us there. Quick shout out to our sponsors. We're really proud to have high quality sponsors providing high quality components and services that are critical to high performance and passive house buildings. So with that, it's my pleasure to move over to the presentation at hand and introduce Timothy Locke, who's the managing partner at Opal. As management partner, Timothy specializes in the management and direction of large-scale institutional projects. He's worked closely with a variety of institutional clients to achieve complex programmatic and sustainability goals. Timothy believes firmly in the importance of architectural design in producing transformational outcomes and is committed to maintaining the highest quality of process and integrity of ecological architecture design, practice, and implementation. He received his professional architectural degree with honors from Syracuse University. He then practiced extensively in New York City with several firms on a wide range of residential and commercial design projects. He sits on the Maine AIA Board of Directors, the AIA National Strategic Council, and is the co-chair of the Maine AIA Committee on the Environment. So it's my pleasure to welcome you, Timothy. And I should note, in terms of Opal, maybe you're going to be speaking to this, longtime leaders in the industry, which Timothy is a driver of, including just the fact that they're one of, I think, 15 firms, at least at the time of the writing, that are actually living up to the AIA 2030 challenge, which requires 80% reduction in operational carbon emissions on average across the portfolio of projects. So a great achievement. Unfortunately, there are not more firms doing it, but it's great to see it out there and it being done. And Opal's also looking at things in ways of moving the industry forward, including starting a whole new business in timber HP and bringing wood fiber insulation to the American market in terms of manufacturing. So all exciting stuff. With that, I will finally hand it over here. So welcome, Timothy.
Okay, thank you, Ken. I really appreciate the introduction. I will just say it's 17 firms as of 2020, not 15. So we want to make sure everybody gets credit, get it accurate. So those two firms, whichever two they might have been, don't get mad at us, Ken.
Thank you for the correction. Very important.
It's a very small amount, and we're excited to be part of it and try to continue to advocate for more architectural practices to try to engage with that, because it is, I think, really well aligned with what you're doing at NAPHN. So without further ado, I'm really happy to be here with everyone today and excited to share this project. I was mentioning to Ken that this is actually the first time that we've as a firm or myself personally lectured on this particular project. So it's a maiden voyage of sorts, but I'm really excited to share it with you all. And sorry that I couldn't share it in person back earlier this year. So I'm gonna go ahead and share screen here and we'll get right into it. Maybe I can get a thumbs up that everyone can see my screen from someone. Ken, thank you.
You're good.
So the Waring School is a project in Beverly, Massachusetts. It's a small sixth grade through 12th grade private school that sits on a campus made almost entirely of old residential suburban building stock. It's about 30 minutes from downtown Boston for those that don't know the area surrounding Boston. And the school has been in existence since the early 1970s and founded by a single family that lived in that area. We were brought onto the project in early 2019, and it's been an exciting partnership ever since with them. What we're looking at today, I think, if we want to focus on some learning objectives to get out of this session, for us, and this is kind of really specific to the way we practice ecology in our office now, is understanding the role of Passive House within a holistic ecological framework. That's how we approach all projects in our office. Solving dynamic design criteria can require complex building forms. I think that we learn in Passive House when we are early adopters or folks that have been in Passive House for a while that you should really kind of try to prioritize a efficient building form. But what we learn as architects is sometimes that's not possible. That's not practically possible because of other constraints in the project. And so we've always been interested at Opal and previously when we were geologic at exploring how Passive House can morph into different form options. Diverse occupancy patterns and challenges. That's always, as we all know, a challenge when we adopt passive house to non-residential typologies. So this is a school building, an academic classroom building. Building process and partnerships. So how do we relate with not just our consultants, but the school communities as well to make sure that we get synergy in those different criteria. I gotta hide my floating meeting controls. Leaning into what is available. This is a project where we didn't have a lot of options. As I said about the building form, you'll see that on the site too, that it's a very hemmed in, you know, very dense site, even though it's a suburban context, just in the way the setbacks forced a certain building footprint, and not having options to just say, face the building the orientation that we'd like to potentially for optimizing passive house. But for all the architects in the room, I like to start a lot of my lectures with this image, which is Loger's primitive hut woodcut from the Encyclopedia on Architecture from the late 1700s. And the reason I do this is because it's really important for us to understand where we're coming from in our practice architecturally, that the history of kind of modern architectural practice is premised around this idea of a humanist approach to architecture, where the shelters that we create are somehow separate from the quote unquote natural world. And it creates a dichotomy of idealism versus materialism that at Opal we're actively trying to work against, right? That like one of the things that was really exciting to us as early adopters in passive house design is that it did not take an idealized approach or a humanist approach to buildings, right? That buildings had a direct ecological relationship to the ecosystems that they affected, because we're taking a science-based approach on how those outcomes potentially are improved or damaged, right? And so at Opal, we're always trying to say, okay, we have an ecological, debt here that we need to be considering. And it's again about getting out of this dichotomy that there's somehow a natural world, and then there's also a built human world, and they're somehow different. You know, we are species that exist on the planet like any other species. Our natural inclination is to construct our reality, and therefore that reality has an ecological impact and responsibility. So it's really about this, it's about seeing, you know, the built environment as just part of ecology and not something that's separate or in competition with it. So we kind of have this mantra that buildings material, materials ecological, and therefore buildings ecological. And if we think about it in that framework, which we think is very aligned with passive house, then it opens up opportunities for potential improvements and not necessarily just thinking about all the buildings as drawbacks. And that's incredibly prescient now because we have one Earth's worth of resources. We're not currently farming other planets for resources. Maybe that'll happen in the future. It's not happening now. Yet per capita across the globe, we use 1.7 Earth's worth of resources. And in the US, we use 4. So we have an oversized burden that we need to address here when we're designing in the US in particular, on how we're extracting resources. And of course, energy is one of those resources, and passive house relates to that. And so I love this David Graeber quote from Utopia of Rules, because it's a great way to kind of govern our practice, is that continue to remind ourselves that the ultimate hidden truth of the world is that it's something that we make. We can just as easily be making it differently. These are arbitrary choices we've made to decide to do things or design things a certain way. And what we're always asking ourselves at Opal is, can you do it? Can you do it different? Is there a different way to do it that will produce a better outcome? And that left us with our kind of firm mission statement, which is, what if our buildings improved our world? What if we don't just assume that they're detractors, okay? And to us, that is just a growth of passive house, right? It's like saying, okay, passive house is a framework that assumes that going in. If you're going to hit that criteria, you're going to create a building that's drawing down energy use. And so that's an improvement. What if we could think about that holistically and ecologically, though? And that led us to this kind of like crazy scientific approach to ecology, what we call building ecology. We have all these frameworks that exist. One of them is actually one of our clients here, Ecology Atlantic, but we also have LEED, we have Living Building Challenge, we have Passive House, we have Well Building, these kind of four main sustainability certification criteria. And they have all these different criteria within them, the sub-criteria, right? And so we just took it and built out this huge kind of what we're calling the periodic table of building ecology. First, it's on purpose that you can't read it, because this is how many criteria exist out there. And how can we start to filter it down? So we started to color code them each into these five governing categories, energy, resources, water, ecology, and community health, site environment and community health, and just color coded them across all the criteria, and then sorted them into their individual categories. So we could get out of this idea of like, are we certifying X or certifying Y? I don't care what we're certifying. Let's take all the criteria and put them in a big ordered table. This thing sits 84 inches wide behind my desk every day. So I'm not at my desk today. Unfortunately, I'm offsite at a job site. But if I was doing this Zoom from my desk, and any Zoom that I do now, people can see this periodic table right behind my head on every Zoom call. And it's what I think about on every project and trying to assess what are the main governing criteria and opportunities for that project. And it was quite obvious on the Waring School that habitable planet and stable climate, which is how we talk, where we're talking about energy, operational carbon and embodied carbon, and local environmental health, because of the sensitive nature of the site, were going to be the primary opportunities on this project. And so rather than thinking about those things as like, oh, these are the big challenges, these are the things that are going to make the building great and differentiate it from other projects, and leaning into those challenges specifically. So those rose to the fore, and it's important for us to consider them in that context, because we like to use this diagram a lot too, which is understanding the community scales of the different impacts of those different nested criteria that we've set up. So those are starting at the biggest scale, the biggest community, which is the community of the planet. That's the habitable planet criteria, this in the yellow here. That's where we're talking about operational efficiency, energy, embodied carbon, and offsetting footprints with renewables, right? Because that affects our, it affects our ability to survive as a species on the planet. So the community is literally the entire globe. And then we kind of move down scalar into these other four criteria. And the interesting thing about that, when we work on projects, it allows us to see the big picture to the small picture, because for the client, these might all be equal in their mind, or in some cases, the community health or some of these lower down nested communities might even be of higher priority to them. But it's important for them to understand the communities they affect by designing and building a building, right? And while the community health aspect or that local site aspect might be of higher priority when they start the project, it's a good way to educate them that every time we draw something, every time we build something, we're also affecting this global community when we talk about energy. And so understanding the nesting isn't about hierarchically saying one thing's more important than the other. It's just it affects a larger community, helps us educate on that. That's the way we now approach all projects, and we call it our building ecology framework that we use at Opal. And Passive House sits within that. It sits mainly in the yellow portion. But what we learn is a lot of these have a conversation with each other. So habitable planet, if we're reducing energy and we're doing well air sealed buildings with healthy interior environments, then we're also going to improve community health too, right? There's a conversation back and forth. So we kind of isolated these two categories in our framework for this project, the habitable planet category and the local environment health. And you'll see why and when we start looking at the project itself. And of course, we always want to start with energy because of the slide that you all know. If you're in Passive House, you know this, of course, that building's biggest impact as far as global community is in energy and in embodied carbon, because of the amount of carbon emissions that buildings are responsible for. Our measurements typically hold it around 40%. Some differ a little bit, but generally, I think it's a pretty well accepted understanding if we start grouping energy in these terms. I think that Passive House kind of sets a good guidepost for this already, because it is outcome-based. And I've seen well-aligned kind of research groups and think tanks kind of group their global warming impacts by the processes that create the impact rather than the outcome that the impacts are the outcome that the impacts are necessitating. So I really like the outcome-based approach, and that's why we frame it this way. So while you might have a lot of transportation global warming potential that goes into building a building or using a building, we like to sort those separately, because if we're trying to think about a different way of building the world or designing our world, then we always want to think about whether the outcome is justified or not, not just if the process uses a lot of carbon or not. So that's why we structure it this way. So moving on to the school itself, it's a project that we call the bridge because of the site constraints and what the building needed to do. And it is about taking a passive house building and make it an accessible in multiple ways, not just the practical reality that the site needed an accessible solution. Like literally their campus did not meet ADA until this building was built, but also that it was making it accessible to a school that did not necessarily have the funds to that might be considered appropriate to do a passive house certified building. So, you know, some of you who might work in educational design, particularly around major urban areas, know kind of the cost per square foot that are required for K-12 buildings these days. And they didn't maybe quite have that level of funding, but they also wanted a passive house certified building. They gave us these kind of really tight criteria. And they were, I'm just going to go down through them. They had a constrictive, inaccessible campus that wasn't ADA compliant that needed to be rectified. You'll see why. They had a really tight budget. They wanted to spend under $300 a square foot for the building itself, exclusive of site. They had an established residential scale, so we couldn't just build a big, massive building block in the middle of a field. They had desired new beacon for campus. It was really important that this capital campaign that they were funding for result in a building that increased their level of interest from the surrounding community. They had passive house certification as a must have, not just passive house design, but certification. And vocal, engaged school community, very horizontal governance, and a really restrictive local ecological overlay. So these were all had to be check boxes. Like we had to meet all of them. And they said, if you want the project, if you want to do it, you have to guarantee us that you'll hit all these check boxes. And we were dumb enough to say, sure, yeah, we'll do that. We'll do all of them and we'll go ahead with it. And the first day we came to campus to meet with the school, we got to witness all school meeting, which is something that happens every single day at Waring School and was meant to be housed in this new building. Now, those of you, all of you, I would assume on this call who understand passive house design can understand maybe, and this is their old all school meeting room, right? Why everyone was asleep after 15 minutes in this classroom, because they packed literally every faculty member and student into this room for 15 minutes. We were in there as well. And this was the amount of space that was left for the head of school. This is Tim Backlund, who's the head of the Waring School. And you could almost feel the oxygen leaving the room, the lack of ventilation. And so they very much wanted to celebrate this event that happens every day as part of their new building and make it the thing that was showcased for somebody driving by at street level. And you could see that space. And of course, it also had to be big enough and had to have fresh air into it all the time, so kids weren't falling asleep literally every afternoon. And that was a big challenge to witness that, you know, literally the first day we were there. And so we immediately turned to the community. They have these kind of collection of different student groups that they call tutorials, each one of which is kind of run by a faculty member. And we gave them all this kind of interview questionnaire and then did a word cloud from all the feedback we got from the students to figure out what's the thing that would make this a successful project? And the resounding thing was they just needed more space. They needed a bigger building. They needed something that was adventurous, something that was sustainable, something that had a small nooks that would allow them to kind of do the breakout sessions that they typically do in their teaching pedagogy. And that was a fun way to kind of start to reflect that back to the community and was something that was really able to get the community on board and engaged. And that was about us as architects kind of really understanding and listening to what was needed, regardless of how we knew it might or might not affect the building form or make it harder to certify passive house and not being draconian about that at the beginning. The other big thing was this accessibility issue. This is a suburban campus, an old residential neighborhood that had an 11-foot grade drop just in the depth of the site of the new building. And that's what they called their entry court and their upper campus. And that was navigated currently by this long road that kind of wound around. So anyone with a disability was having to get driven up to upper campus to their classroom build, to their other classroom buildings. And one of the goals of the project was that it had to kind of make this bridge that connected the lower campus to the upper campus. So that became this big formal challenge, and that, you know, the obvious solution for Passive House would be that we could make a very rectangular boxy building and then have an outdoor bridge connecting it. But we felt like that's a missed opportunity to actually listen to the need and the site that was telling us what we could or couldn't do in this case. And so we kind of abandoned that right away. We said, yeah, that'd be the easiest thing to certify. We're not going to do that. It might even be the cheapest thing to build, but it's not going to really solve their problems, because it's not really good universal design approach to make this building and then force someone with a disability to then walk across this long bridge exterior in, you know, northern New England, exposed to the elements. So instead we said, let's question the bridge idea and let's make the building the bridge. Let's use portions of the program, move it, and allow it to connect to the upper portion of campus. So that was kind of the initial design approach, to say, let's lean into this and see how that can work. So the initial move was to take a portion of the program of the building, bridge it across like a literal bridge. There's nothing underneath that piece that connects up to the upper campus, and then just kink it to the point where it hits grade, right? Just bend it until it hits grade and meets the existing road and sidewalk on upper campus. And then that was kind of the thing that unlocked the site for us, is that once we did that, we could keep the footprint smaller on the ground floor, which is helpful, which you'll see why in a second. And they had their accessibility issues completely solved, because someone could, in any weather, get from lower campus to upper campus inside the building without having to go winding all around, or worse, get driven up to upper campus. It was a big aha moment, kind of breakthrough. Now, what we didn't know is how would that affect Passive House, and we'll get to that in a second. So here you kind of see a rendered elevation of that and the actual kind of peek through underneath the bridge, which is still an accessible pathway through the site. We retained that all the way through. It's bridged structurally up and over. And then that second floor just reaches across and meets upper campus. So that's kind of was the strategy and what we ran with throughout the project. And that happens through the section as well. It's actually the portion that cuts all the way through the building. You can see the all school meeting space that then looks out back to the street as the beacon back to the main street that they wanted. And then it gets compressed and you can walk along the bridge with windows looking out over the preserved natural landscape to the south, south and west, and then out to the upper campus portion of the building. I also had to house these two very large spaces. The first one on the top we talked about, which is the all school meeting space. The second was unique to Waring School, which is their grand salle. It's a French language immersion school as well. And it also has a concentration in music. All students are expected to learn an instrument. So in the grand salle every day, you'll also have congregations of every student, and they have a piano in there that anyone can play. And so there'll be impromptu instances of people playing the piano and singing. You could have the entire student body in this space as well. So from a Passive House perspective, the ability to have two rooms that could house the entire student body, which isn't huge, it's only about 180 students, but at any point in time was a challenge, because what it meant was we had to constantly be changing where we were moving the ventilation. We didn't want to over-ventilate because we knew that the classrooms wouldn't be used at those times. But the ventilation system had to be smart enough to modulate between both conditions. And then we got into the challenges of the site, which I mentioned as well. So site was incredibly constricted. We had this existing building that got demolished, this kind of winding red line you see below. We had to have that access, that beacon component. We had an offset from this intermittent stream, which is shown in blue. And then we had this larger ring, this is in red, which was a limit of work ring. We couldn't go beyond that because of a river that was, it's not even on the site plan that you see. And so it really kind of constrained where we could even build. All this nice flat area that you see up in this location, couldn't build in it, too close to this river that was, you know, another 300 feet off the site. So an opportunity for a very simple construction was off the table completely. The rest of the site leaning out towards the road already had buildings or ball fields, sports fields on it. So it was really this spot or nothing, not to mention that those other spots wouldn't have solved the ADA problem. So again, we just leaned into that and went for it. And it created this situation where we had to have developed these like really stringent stormwater management ecological responses as well, because we had such a small footprint, we could not increase the amount of disturbed area at all. All the paving had to be percolating paving, not just impervious pavers, but actually had to hold a certain amount of water below it. So the entire entry court has a substructure that's 2 feet deep to hold water. Not only that, but one portion of the upper roof is actually a blue roof. It's meant to hold water. And so it has a trickle drain in it. It's a flat roof with a trickle drain. And it's for 72 hours in a large storm, that roof will hold water and slowly let the water through. That ended up being actually a good overlay with Passive House because it forced an even deeper structure, which allowed even more insulation in the roof of that flat roof, which was a kind of nice synergy. And then that water is then slowly released subgrade into the landscape over time, as over that 72 hours, as I said. So there's all these other ecological overlays that what we're trying to do with our framework as a practice is be willing to accept those and not necessarily say, well, that's a conflict to Passive House, we can't do it, you know? But just say, we can try to make these challenges all work together in ways that help each other, not hurt each other. So this is just that view from upper campus. Again, these are the rendered views. We'll get into the construction in just a second. And you can kind of see from that upper campus, that residential scale or uphill, and they're occupying old houses, that it looks like a one-story building from there because you're only seeing the second story stretching across. But then you see that taller building from below to be that beacon as you enter campus. And then this was the early rendering of the all school meeting, just becoming this big glassy space and kind of instead of that hermetic inward looking forum that they had before. The plan, essentially the first floor is just a simple bar building, entry, that grand south space, a classroom and a cluster of offices across the pathway that connects under the bridge. And then the upstairs is the larger floor where it has two large classrooms plus the all school meeting classroom, several other faculty offices and conference rooms, the head of school's office, faculty lounge, and then this kind of big interior street that allows them to connect up to that upper campus portion that has all these kind of breakout spaces for studying and hanging out. You'll see those later in the construction as well. Those big spaces allowed us to kind of effectively modulate the internal gains in a really effective way. We put all those spaces on the non-south side, on the north side, to make sure that we're not getting increased gains in the areas that were also getting solar gain. And we got a pretty even distribution, which we're always looking for in Passive House, as you all know, of active space heating, internal gains from people and the sun, the solar gains. It was pretty evenly split, worked out quite well in the end, even though the building has a lot of surface area. And on the second floor, it was that shift to kind of meet grade allowed us to actually kind of get some solar south glazing in that center corridor, which is nice because those spaces are warm, but they're not highly occupied, they're transient spaces. So when we do school buildings now, we know enough to not put our classrooms on that side because they overheat, but we try to always put our corridors on the south. So we still can get the solar gain, move that heat around the building with the ventilation system and have warm spaces that you're circulating through, even if you're not actively getting educated in them. And so that actually worked out quite well. Kind of solar south is right in that notch, that upper bridge. The assembly was a mixed construction type, steel and wood primary structure with concrete foundation, 2x8 stud infill wall, cellulose fill with continuous 6-inch EPS insulation. This was kind of before our heavy, designed before our kind of heavy investment in wood fiber insulation, which Ken mentioned. So this is kind of predates that, but the assembly is essentially commercial construction, super insulated. No double walls here, none of that. We did have a few cantilevers that we did with wood trusses, Unilux modern line windows and fine line curtain wall, approximate average U value for the window of 0.1, and Conier 500T doors. We are just using, you know, standard, or not standard, but stock domestic doors. So those are double glazed in this case. But we've found on the larger buildings that it doesn't actually take too much, it doesn't hurt our overall heat load calcs to go to double glazed just on those small portions of the building, and they can meet American with Disabilities Act much easier than our current European options. And then the siding is essentially stucco and wood throughout, stucco on the ground floor and all wood on the upper floors. The systems, it's a LGVRF heating and cooling system, 2000 CFM Ventacity rooftop ERV. So shout out to one of your sponsors here. And thanks so much to Barry at Ventacity who helped throughout the process, including after when we realized that the facilities manager changed all the settings on the building management system and there was no air going to the all school meeting. So that was very helpful. And then point of use domestic hot water throughout the building. So we didn't do centralized hot water heating in this case because there's not a lot of hot water use in academics anyway. And so we just did point of use at each of the sinks. We, you know, obviously have to run this all PHPP, as you all know. I should mention now that this is in the process of post-construction evaluation by Peel Passive and PHI. So we don't actually have the certificate yet, but we've gotten through all the design portion. We're just going through the construction portion now for final sign off. That should be done in about a month or so. We also, as we do in all of our projects now, and you saw from Ecological Framework, do full life cycle analysis on all of our buildings. So that is looking at embodied carbon. And we did that on this building as well, even though this isn't a mass timber building. We still try to do it on all projects to see where we're hitting. And we're pleasantly surprised here. The mixed use construction, we've learned over time that combining wood with steel is actually a pretty good approach to embodied carbon. Steel is about 99% recycled content these days. And so it actually does have a pretty good LCA impact versus other materials like concrete. So we're not afraid of using these hybrid systems necessarily. But this is all wood and steel with the exception of the slab on grade foundation. And we actually were able to reduce some of that concrete too because of the bridge. There's a significant portion of square footage on the second floor that has no slab because of stretching across to meet that upper campus portion. So we're at about just over 200,000 kilograms of CO2 embodied, which is 17.4 kg CO2 per square foot, which is interestingly kind of mostly offset by the wood, even though it's not a primarily wood structure. You still get some sequestration from the wood, which is nice to see. And it's a 52% reduction from the national average, which we're always assessing on all of our architectural projects. This was designed built during COVID. This project literally started February 2019. That's when we broke ground. And then February 2020. That's when we broke ground. And then everything shut down. I couldn't even go to the site for over a month. And the contractor mailed me this notebook. And the contractor is a great advocate. The whole project, it was their first passive house. It's LB Russo out of Newburyport, Mass. And we couldn't have asked for a better partner. And I think this set everything right that Nat emailed me and said, I'm sending you a gift. And I opened it up when it comes the next week. I was like, okay, this is gonna be the mantra of the project. We're gonna see how much we can do this over email because we're not gonna be able to meet. And we did finally, we were able to get back to the site. This was the foundation and the initial structural frame going in. You can kind of see the hybrid system. Steel and wood. So we have some kind of engineered wood and steel kind of working together. Lots of beam penetrations had to be coordinated in this project just because of that tight relationship between the upper story and the ground floor, because we had to hit that elevation at upper campus. Here you can kind of see the zip sheathing going on. Again, that's part of the typical commercial system that we do on most projects now to lean into a building assembly that most commercial contractors know how to do, just with thicker insulation layers. This is them just putting together the zip over the bridge. You can kind of see through that there. And this is from the front, and you can kind of see the big windows that are going to be the all-school meeting room. This is looking back down, down the hill, across the bridge, see there. This is inside that Grand Salle room. It's our owner's rep, Craig Douglas, who's an architect out of Newburyport, Mass. As well. And he was really instrumental in kind of shepherding the project forward. We had to have a locker for literally every student in the school, locker or cubby. This is that room that will house the piano. And then they wanted this big open stair that would connect the upper and lower stories. Again, some images of the all-school meeting, kind of looking out through during the construction phase. You can kind of see on the left, the fine line, Unilux fine line curtain wall going in with exposed structure there. These are just risers, and you can see, you'll see all the kids in them in a bit. This is an aerial drone shot we took, which was, I think, really helpful to kind of explain the constraints of the site. That upper, that plus 11 foot red line is that upper campus that we needed to hit. You can see we literally made the angle of the wall just exactly that road angle. So it hits right at that, that upper portion. And then the setback, that 250 foot setback from the river that I talked about, that angle is literally hitting that setback. So we're kind of hemmed in on both sides. And then the back edge of the building on the ground floor is just where that slope starts. So we could have the pathway going under the bridge. And then we deliberately preserved all of these trees on either side of the bridge, because there was another conservation overlay that literally every inch of diameter of tree had to be replaced if you cut it. So we tried to thread this bridge through, cut as few trees as possible, and we were able to keep even these huge pines right next to the building. A really excellent work by the crane operator for this building to make that happen. So now just some finished images, and then we'll wrap for questions. This is a view of the all-school meeting at the end of the project, looking out, filled with all the kids, a lot more space now. Nobody's falling asleep, especially after we fixed the BMS, that helped. Just some of the details, all this kind of, always just this wood and painted steel in combination. This is the Grand Salle. Yes, I have to sometimes model, that's me walking up the stairs, modeling the architectural photos. And this is the entry to the school. Again, keeping that kind of residential scale entry, never it feeling too large or too much like a public or large scale public school. This is the view down from that open street on the upstairs, down through the open stair into the Grand Salle. And then that open street, this is all cork flooring upstairs, looking out to upper campus through that connecting bridge. View from their sports fields, looking at the building. This is just off the street. You can kind of see that large window there is the all-school meeting space, looking back out from upper campus. And again, looking back down that street, same thing, that upper hallway. Again, you might remember this back to the rendering view, again, trying to keep that small scale when we're up top and upper campus in that residential context. Under the bridge, back through, and interestingly enough, you know, we've been there a few times and school has been in session and they still use this path all the time. Kids love the adventure aspect of hanging out under the bridge, doing things under the bridge, little craft projects and stuff. Very cool, interesting space. Here's just a view of those massive pines that we were able to preserve. It was a fun aspect of the project. We were able to do that. All of these pavers that are meant to hold water and absorb water into the soil. So these might look like standard pavers, but they're all set in a 2-foot bed of percolating substrate. Pretty fun aspect of the project. Oh, that's a double up. And then just a night shot looking back. And then looking back out over the sports fields from upper campus, that's that bridge piece. So our final design PHPP, we're able to pass all of our thresholds. Again, we're in the post-construction evaluation right now by PHI, and Peel Passive was a great partner in working with us through that. So shout out to Stephen Quinn on that, who is the project manager. And thank you so much for that help. He's on leave right now, unfortunately, so he's not joining us. But and then Van Zelm Engineers out of Norwalk, Connecticut, and Thornton Tomasetti, a structural engineer out of Portland, Maine. So the final stats, 4.39 kbt per square foot per year, 21.54 kbt per square foot non-renewable primary energy. We tested, the tested blower door was 0.48 ACH at 50 pascals, 10.4 kbtu square foot per year modeled EUI. So for all you architects that are on the AA 2030 challenge, that's an 87% reduction from national average for educational buildings. So it meets the 2020 and the 2025 AIA standard criteria, which is great. And then 17.4 kg CO2 SF per SF embodied global warming potential. So that's the carbon debt, and that's a 52% reduction from national average. So really excited to share this with you today. Excited to hear your questions. And yeah, it's really fun.
Fantastic. Thank you, Timothy. Tim, it was wonderful. So let me pin myself, I think, and we'll have a little conversation here. Please add questions to the chat if you have them. I certainly have questions. And the one that came out of the audience right off the bat, I think Justin threw it right out there, was how do they get the copy of your periodic table? I think they want high res, be able to print it out full size.
Yeah, we do intend, once the framework is a little bit more developed, to make it open source, but there's a little bit that we need to do to get to that point.
Still tweaking it.
Still a couple months from that. We're trying to get to that by the first part of next year. So say Q1 2023, that's the goal. So can't share it yet, unfortunately.
Okay,
well, soon, now we know. Soon it's gonna happen.
Justin, maybe you can do a screenshot of a presentation that Tim's doing at his desk.
You'll see it. If you keep checking our website, you'll see it in Q1 next year.
Fair enough. So a few things. One is great to see the client just out of the gate say, we have to do Passive House, right? And that is a core requirement. We always say, this is one of the fundamental approaches to being successful with it, is to say it's non-negotiable, that it's not an ad alternate to the project in that performance. You know, but it, then the next requirement is that it needs, that you have a tight budget. Mm-hmm. And we naturally see, you know, sort of a conflict there sometimes. Sometimes it's easier, sometimes it's more difficult to make that work. Sometimes you need to be more creative. And I'm curious, along the course of the project, where you came to crunch points and said, you know, we need to do this to make it work, we need to do that, or what that sort of process was like. And before you answer, one thing I think I remember correctly that they didn't put on the must-have list was a beautiful building. But you did a beautiful building. And so to do that, and Passive House and cost, and everything else is quite an accomplishment. So maybe speak to those tensions a little bit.
Yeah, I will say that interestingly, I don't think that we really came across any points where there was tension related to Passive House versus what's called the traditional argument, which is like Passive House versus architecture, Passive House versus program. Because I think the reason that that's the case, and this is what I kind of advocate to say groups that I talk to that maybe aren't familiar with Passive House but want to adopt, you know, ecological principles and design, is to say, you know, we choose the criteria that we choose to govern our design work. That's elective. And if we choose to allow that criteria to be building performance, then the client doesn't necessarily need to know that that's the criteria, right? Like, and
right.
So the more times we can find synergies that are beautiful and solve an energy problem that we know might be coming down the road, then the less the client needs to be forced into those question points. Now, there were a couple instances where there was program versus passive house questions. I can go back to it, but you may have noticed in one of the early plans, there was actually a walkout roof deck on the north side of the building. I'll maybe try to navigate to that while I...
There was like a cutout, right?
Yeah, while I'm talking, I'll go to it. You can see it here. There was an open roof deck just to the north of the building. And we eventually told them that like, this is gonna cost more and it's gonna be harder for you to achieve your heating goals and air sealing goals. And we think that there's some risk here. We don't think that it's a design element that we think is so sacred as architects that you should keep it. And so eventually they just build more square footage and they just put more building there. So they actually got a cheaper building with more square footage and a building that was easier to certify marginally. I mean, there's still a lot of ins and outs in this building, a lot of psi values to calculate, but it was one less thing that we had to deal with, one less air sealing transition that I was really worried about. And, they lost a bit of program. They had to make that choice. There really wasn't a ton of those instances. And I think that is because of our approach. Not trying to say that we do it better or anything, but we've done it for a long time. We've done passive house exclusively for a long time on all our projects. So we kind of know where those potholes are coming. So we can try to see if we can avoid ever having to navigate them.
Right. Well, I guess it's kind of like to build on that, because of your experience, but you're also dealing with a pretty wide range of budgets, right? In some of these projects, from project to project.
Yep.
So when you're coming in with a lean and mean institutional project, are you making systems decisions right off the bat and saying, CLT is not in the cards here? And
super good point. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's definitely the toolkit is different for a project that has to hit $300 a square foot versus one that hits $600 a square foot. And what I typically say is that, if you are an architect, you're on this call, the thing that I would really recommend hearing is that you're in control of that. Like you can be your own worst enemy by holding some of those details and finishes so sacred that they undermine you, right? Because the tension isn't going to be between the client is almost always going to choose program because they need it, right? They need it to operate their school or whatever. So if you are holding something particularly sacred and you know it could be a budget violation, and you also want to meet passive house or some other stringent energy criteria, you better rethink that because it's going to be you against you.
right, exactly.
So, we didn't bring any of that baggage to this project. I still think that, we were able to use a lighter toolkit to make sure that the building was still beautiful, was still transformative to the campus, was still something that, has increased enrollment so much that they now have a wait list, which they've never had. And they definitely think the building is part of that, just having it, not necessarily that it's certified, but having it. And we didn't become a roadblock to that. You can easily become a roadblock to that if you hold some of that stuff too sacred, I think.
And given the hybrid construction that you ended up going with, did that complicate in terms of your practice, like how you're thinking about thermal bridges and the number of calculations that you would need to do? And then to extend on that, are you doing the energy modeling in-house or are you working with outside consultants?
Yeah, so we, since we have been doing passive house on all projects since 2010 with the go home, we do our own energy modeling throughout design on every project. We have Michael Bailey, who's our certified passive house designer in the office, who does PHPP on projects that demand it. But even our own internal energy model is heavily PHPP influenced. So we have a lot of confidence even in that. So if we run our internal energy model in SD, in schematic design, and know that it's passing, we feel pretty confident just based on our track record of buildings that we've certified that it'll probably pass PHPP too. So we can then go to a client without a consultant and say, you have a passive house here. if you want to do it. That's huge help, but that's, you know, years. I mean, it's over a decade now of doing that on every project without fail to know confidently that that's the case. So yes, all our own internal energy modeling, you know, Michael did model all of these thermal bridges himself, which was a lot of work because that complex structure.
And Andrew, you know, particularly, signing off on them.
Well, it's Stephen, yeah, but yeah,
he's at this point
signed off on all of them, yes. So now it's just the construction photos part. These types of details were bridging, and the air barrier eventually had to get around all of that. Also took just an incredible amount of dedication for a contractor that had never done a certified passive house before to really pay attention and do it all. And they did, you know, and they were dedicated. They got all of those details as drawn, built, to get around all the little beam penetrations, all of the steels poking through the air barrier and getting it taped off well.
Right.
So it was pretty rigorous, but it took the whole team to do that. That was definitely where a significant portion of the money was spent to make sure that bridge could happen, you know, in a way that worked. So.
Yeah, that makes sense. A couple of programmatic things and mechanical. Was there a kitchen in this building? And is that just outside of the program? So you didn't have to deal with that.
There was no kitchen. There is a tiny little kitchenette for the faculty, but nothing that I would, it's just a sink and a stove and a dishwasher, residential level. There's no dining hall in this building. This is purely academic building.
Got it.
So that's a benefit. You know, we have done, I think, project maybe you all might know, Al Nobo, which does have a commercial kitchen in it. We've done that before, but not here, thankfully. That would have been maybe one challenge too many, potentially. I don't know. We'll see. Sure, I'll get the project at some point where it wants a kitchen too, but.
Very good. Well, somewhat related, I think there's a question out there regarding, you know, these big high occupancy spaces and juggling the ventilation loads and the cooling and heating. And was there any particular strategy or something that you sort of summarized?
Yeah. So, I mean, my big thing on that is that when I try to talk to our mechanical engineers at the beginning of the project is to make sure that we're understanding the occupancy patterns accurately, because what we've found is that there can be a trend, even in really good mechanical engineers that understand passive house, which these certainly did, it's almost a great partner, to oversize for those peak loads and not understand that those occupancies, particularly in a classroom building for K-12, are always non-simultaneous because it can't be in two places at once, right? So making sure we have a system that can effectively modulate, making sure we're actually spending some money on a building management system and not just assuming that the package that comes with the system will handle it, that we are deliberately programming it so that that air shift will happen when the population migrates from one part of the building to another, that's really, really important. And so what we find on our higher occupancy buildings is there's a lot of time spent at the beginning of the project with a mechanical engineer on getting an actual full-time equivalent number. And so for those that might not know, that's just if we were to set up a ratio of the peak versus how many that would equate to if someone was in there a full day at the same occupancy rate. You end up with a full-time equivalent that's often quite a bit lower than that peak load that might freak people out. And if we can get that established well, then typically the systems don't have to be so huge that they become cumbersome, hard to use, or energy hogs that drive our primary energy through the roof. And then just having good equipment, right? Like getting a ventacity unit in the project, you know, versus getting it like value engineered down to something that doesn't have very high performance is a huge help.
Right. And speaking of, and the components, I mean, that's the one big thing we also see in windows, having good quality windows as a big, trade-off in terms of performance and having control thermally. I'm curious, the windows, just a reminder, there was a question, I can't remember it. Who supplied your windows? Was it?
Yeah, We're Unilux. We used Unilux.
Unilux, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And they don't actually offer a certified product, but we'd use them before on a certified building. So we're able to reuse those values again, a building that had already been certified with PHI. So we deliberately chose them because we knew we had the data. There's other systems that we use on other projects that do have certified components. Obviously that's easier, but we knew we could fall back on data that we already had from another certified project, PHI.
Right. That's an interesting strategy to, if you're going off certification for the component, to reuse it. So you're plugging in.
Yeah.
In terms of occupancy, when was it occupied? This fall or
full occupancy started September 2021.
A year ago. A year ago. So how do students like it? How does everybody dig it?
The students I talked to seem fine with it. It's hard to do a post-occupancy evaluation with high school kids. They don't really care.
Yeah, I was thinking under the bridge where you were saying they were doing arts and crafts. I was like, are you kidding? That's the smoking area.
Well, I mean, it's pretty open. It's pretty tall in there, but a pretty good oversight. But they kids seem to like it. Because they have more space now, more places to hang out. The old Grand Sal was like dingy and gross, and so they love that. I think the faculty likes it a lot because they were cramped with space as well. I know the head of school and development love it because, again, it's nice to have this notable project that suddenly can drive admissions and excitement in the area. So it's been, I think, universally pretty widely accepted. The facilities department it's one person, has had a hard time grappling with just not screwing around with the systems.
My next question about the operations. And what about the education in occupancy for the building manager, but also the staff? Like, is there?
Yeah, so it's always a challenge with all institutional projects, is that the hardest group to kind of corral is your facilities manager, building manager, and the faculty and staff who have offices in the building, because they just want to habitually ratchet up the heat, ratchet down the heat, whatever. And worse, when someone gets the sexy new toy of a building management system and they have a computer screen that looks like a video game that they can play around with, we learned through a 2-hour meeting inside the building management head end unit room with the mechanical engineer, myself, the owner's rep, the contractor, and the facilities manager, that at the end of the 2 hours, we learned that he just changed a setting on how much air could be supplied to the all school meeting, which is why the CO2 levels were going too high. And it took the entire 2 hours for him to finally admit that he'd changed something. It's a challenge at the end of a project, particularly on a passive house, because people need to learn that they don't need to do anything, like just don't touch it, which is new to them. And that's not a criticism, it's just new. And we have to spend the time to do it, to educate.
Yeah, very good. So we're over time. There was one, just a group of two questions, I think. And then one about the columns coming down from the bridge and just basically thermal bridging. Was it difficult or kind of like every day? Sort of situation. How you dealt with that? Did you need to calculate them
with the columns specifically?
Thermally broke them. Yes.
Yep. They're thermally broken at that spot. There is another layer above where it hits the structure, that's the flooring system. So we did have the ability to break it a little bit. It's not, I would call it a true thermal break, but we just did ran a thermal bridge calc on those two spots. There's a couple other spots in the building that have thermal bridges as well. And what we've learned is that, you know, as the buildings get bigger and there's more interior space to that exterior envelope, even in a complex building form like this, that if you do that enough times in PHPP, you'll realize that you can afford a little bit more thermal bridging in some spots. Right. And to not necessarily get so dogmatic about it that it becomes a problem, because you can end up in a situation where you can't actually achieve your design goals or programmatic goals if you don't allow yourself a little flexibility. But that comes with scale. Like, as the building gets bigger, you get a little bit more fudge factor on that. And we just kind of knew that going in. We're like, okay, we've done enough buildings at this scale at this point to know that two thermal bridges in those spots is probably not going to be a deal breaker, particularly given how thick that insulation level is in that bridge connection. And it turned out to not be an issue. In fact, the PHPP came in even under our internal energy model in space heating, even after all the psi values were calculated. So we felt pretty good about it, that ahead of time that it wouldn't be an issue, and just accepted it.
That's cool. So when in the schematic design, when you're doing your internal model, you're not, you're using PHPP, or you're using something else?
We use our own model that we developed off of PHPP, but not actual file PHPP, but we just built our own Excel sheet, basically, because we needed to be simple enough that any project manager on any project could run it, right? We don't want to be at the beginning of a project having to run PHPP every time, because it just takes too long. So we took out elements that we knew that we could make average assessments on, and built our own Excel sheet formula, you know, just multi-tab Excel sheet that would allow anybody in our firm, even young architects, to join and just enter in the values and kind of know generally where we're at. And then if the client wants to do certification, great, we can get it into PHPP. We have, you know, certified PASFAS designers on staff, and they can run the PHPP, but that's not necessarily for every project. We know that our internal energy model is going to get us close enough to know whether it's certifiable or not, and report out information. So,
really interesting. And when are you prepared to make that public?
That probably will never be public, unfortunately. There's plenty of, thankfully, Ken, that, like, these days, there's enough free energy modeling software that people don't ask for that anymore.
Yeah.
I would also say that anyone can make a thermal conductivity Excel model. It's very easy.
Right, sure.
These are not complex equations.
And as Vlad points out in the comments, the design pH is really functioning in that role as well.
Right.
Is a different way to get to and
absolutely
get it out of the spreadsheet. So many ways to go at it.
Tons of ways.
This is great.
It. Yeah.
Wonderful project.
Thank you.
So good to talk with you and share it with everyone. Thank you for joining us, and hope you can all join us for the Ask the Certifiers, Passive House Certifiers program on December 13th, and more stuff beyond.
Well, thank you so much, Ken, and I hope to see everybody in Denver next year in person.
That would be great.
Yeah,
look forward to it.